Thank you very much. It's great to be with you tonight. And I'm going to speak tonight on how to find your heart. And I just wonder tonight, wherever you are in this Oxford Town Hall, how you feel about what's really going on in your heart right now. What would you say? Would you say you're at peace? You have peace in your heart? Would you say you're anxious? Would you say you're confident? Would you say you feel a little bit insecure? Would you describe your heart as tough or fragile? Does your heart feel hard or does it feel soft? And one of the things that has a huge impact on how our hearts feel, how we feel, is this sense, whether we acknowledge it or not, this sense that as we go through life, there are standards that we feel we have to meet. Standards we're trying to meet, a level of performance we're trying to hit. And there are some times, like when you're studying at a place like Oxford, when the standard is actually really clear and it's really obvious. So for some of you, it might be 69.6%. That's your standard that you have to meet. Some of you, it might be 59.6%, depending on how the last few terms have gone. But you kind of get the sense that it's really obvious. I know what I'm aiming for, but there are times in life when it's a bit harder to see, but there are always standards there. We have a sense that we want to achieve something. We want to hit that mark. We want our lives to make a difference. We want to make an impact. We want to know that we're making a difference. And when I started working as a barrister, I was really conscious of this standard. I mean, no one spelt it out to me, no one articulated it to me, no one described it to me, but I just had in my head that there was a standard you had to hit as a barrister. You had to be learned, you had to be experienced, you probably had to have grey hair. And the problem was, I was 22 years old and I looked about 15. So I had a deep insecurity about the fact I wasn't going to hit any of those standards. And I was quite self-conscious about how I looked. I was quite self-conscious about the fact that I might not hit those standards. And in one of my first major cases, a trial where I was in the Crown Court, it concerned a guy who was just 15 years old, a young person, and he was alleged to have stabbed someone on a bus. And because he was young, there's this rule that judges can use in the Crown Court where they can say, in order to make it a bit nicer for this poor young 16-year-old, 15-year-old who's accused of stabbing someone, you know, make it a bit nicer for him. We will all take off our wigs and our gowns in the court, and then he won't feel intimidated when he comes into the court and all look nice and friendly. And some judges, you know, caring, compassionate judges, think this is a great idea. Some judges don't like the idea that people will find a court a friendly place. And so, but you never really know when you turn up for court which of those it's going to be. Whether the judge is going to want you to have your wig and gown on or want you to have it off. And I had completely forgotten about this rule, and I turned up. This is one of my first trials. I'm there in court looking about 15 years old and quite nervous about the day that's about to happen. And I suddenly thought, oh, should I have my wig on or my wig off? Should I have my wig on or my wig off? And I was just thinking, wig on, wig off, wig on, wig off. What shall I do? And I was just thinking, actually, I want to make sure I get this right. I don't want to get off on the wrong foot with this judge. So it's probably easier to take a wig off than it is to put a wig on. So I'll leave it on. And then if the judge asks me to take it off, I can take it off very quickly. And while I was kind of agonizing about this decision, unbeknownst to me, the young defendant had walked in to court behind me, and he'd gone into the dock behind me, and he was wearing a baseball cap, and he'd just kind of stood there in the dock. And then suddenly, all of a sudden, I'm still thinking, wig on, wig off, wig on, wig off. The door of the court opens, and the judge comes in, and everyone stands up and rises, and the judge walks into the courtroom. He stops halfway in. He looks right at me, and he says, young man, take that hat off. And I say, I'm so sorry, Your Honor. And I kind of put it down on the bench. He says, Mr. Foster, what are you doing? I'm not talking to you. I'm talking to the defendant. And the whole court just started roaring with laughter at me. And I went bright red. And then I did feel 15 years old. I was very conscious that day that there was a very clear standard and I hadn't met it. Sometimes it's really obvious. But sometimes it's not so obvious. And there are lots of standards in life, in every place you go. And I just want to suggest tonight that one of the reasons we're so obsessed with those standards is because on a deep level, we're aware, even if we don't acknowledge it, that there's a greater standard, almost a cosmic standard. And we're conscious that we might not come up to that standard. In Romans 3, it says, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And that might sound a bit strange to you, but I wonder how you would feel that actually there's so many standards in life and we're so obsessed with them. And one of the reasons is that deep down, we know there's an ultimate standard and we're fearful that we might not come up to that standard. And when we're insecure that we might not meet a standard, there's a number of ways we can respond. The first thing we can do is we can try and puff ourselves up and tell ourselves, well, you know, we're going to meet the mark. We are successful. We're hitting all the bases. And if you do that, what happens is that slowly over time, your insecurity pushes you into a place where actually you can become quite proud. And although your successes feel like they're helping you, long term, they hurt you. Or we can be really honest with ourselves and say, actually, we feel like we keep missing all the marks. We are making mistakes. We are getting things wrong. We are letting people down. We are letting ourselves down. We are letting God down. And then we feel a bit like a failure. But what if there was a third option, a way to actually hit the standard in such a way that it didn't make you proud, but actually made you more humble, so that you could stay grounded in your successes and your failures didn't destroy you, but actually refined your character? And that's something that Jesus spoke into. And we're just going to look at a very short story Jesus told in Luke's gospel. You've got a copy of these uncovered gospels on your tables, or if you're on the balconies, they're under your chairs. And that's for you. Take it away. That's my gift to you. It's not actually my gift to you, but I'm just saying, feel free to take that away. Read it. It's a really great thing to read. And we're looking at Luke 18 from verse 9. And Jesus tells this story. To some who were confident of their own righteousness and looked down on everyone else, Jesus told this parable. Two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee stood by himself and prayed, God, I thank you, I am not like other people, robbers, evildoers, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week and I give a tenth of all I get. But the tax collector stood at a distance. He would not even look up to heaven, but beat his breast and said, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. I tell you that this man, rather than the other, went home justified before God. For all those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. Jesus tells this story to those who are convinced of their own righteousness. Those, it literally means those who are trusting in themselves that they are righteous. And we don't use the word righteousness a lot these days, except maybe you might have used it negatively. You might have looked at someone, maybe even someone in this room, you said they're so self-righteous. I'm not going to ask you to say if you thought that. But actually, that's the only real common way that we use that word now. Self-righteous, they're self-righteous. They think they're self-righteous. I wonder if you've ever wondered about what that word means, that phrase means when you use it to describe someone. It actually means something very similar to what's going on in this passage, that they think they're so good in and of themselves that they're righteous in and of themselves, that they don't need anyone else. That they've got this kind of elevated opinion of themselves. And to be righteous means that you have met the standard in your relationship with God and in your relationship with others. It's a really key word in the Bible. It means that you're in the right. You are right. Your relationship is right with God. And it's a really high standard to live in such a way that you're holy, that you're perfect. And it's to those who think that they're righteous, that they're trusting in themselves, that think they don't actually need someone to help them, don't need a rescuer to meet that standard, those who don't think they need God to help them meet that standard, those who are entirely self-sufficient, Jesus tells this story as a warning. And sometimes warnings can sound a bit harsh. We don't like them. We sometimes react against them a little bit. I do. But actually, warnings are one of the kindest things you can give to someone. And warnings motivated by love are a really precious thing. And you might think, well, actually, I'm not sure if I'm against the idea of self-sufficiency. I quite like the sound of that. I like this idea of not relying on anyone else. That sounds like not such a bad idea to me. And I felt like that at times, but I tell you, every time I felt like that, I was kidding myself. I thought I was going to be okay on my own, but I wasn't. And we do a pretty good job. I've done a pretty good job in my life of trying to make myself look perfect, of presenting myself in such a way that I appear perfect. But the truth is, I found it impossible to live up to my own standards, let alone to God's. And you might say, well, come on. I can live up to my own standards. Don't say that about me. I can live up to my own standards. I can live up to my own values. Well, I just want you to imagine this. I want you to imagine that you were crowned king or queen for the day, tomorrow, if you like. You pick the day, maybe tomorrow, maybe the day of your finals. And you have the choice to determine how everyone else should live. You set the rules. You decide what people can do, the things you think are great. You decide the things that people can't do, the things you think are terrible. Some of you are thinking, finally, someone has given me the opportunity I've been longing for my whole life. I can just sort this world out. And you set all those rules down. I just ask you this question. How long do you think it would be before you said something, did something that breached even one of your own rules, one of your own values, one of your own moral code? Do you think it'd be a month? If someone followed you around with a camera, you know, would it be a month, a week, a day? For me, I think it'd be about an hour, to be honest, before I breached even my own. So I've kidded myself that I can make that standard. And one of the things I've done in my life to try and persuade myself I can make that standard is I've tried to put struts in place to make myself feel better, to make myself feel I can come up to that grade on my own without anyone else's help, without God's help. And so I look to my successes or great results or the people I'm seen with, like George there doing his sonnet. It's a really touching piece of poetry. And so all the English students admired the way it's scanned and the brilliant rhyming. There wasn't a single word that was forced, was there? It was amazing to behold. And you look at all the stuff you've achieved, the stuff in my life, and you try and persuade others, you try and persuade yourself that because of those things, you don't need God. Not like other people do, not like the weak people do, not like those who are needy do. I'm okay on my own. But actually what that does is it makes you proud. And the root of pride is actually obsession with yourself and a desire to seek independence from God. And it's so subtle. Pride is like carbon monoxide. It kills character silently. And I've been shocked in my life how quickly pride has got a hold of me. I was convinced I would never struggle with pride because I came from quite a rough background. I was born and bred in the beautiful town of Luton, stunning, beautiful place. You know, you can get walking tours of it. It's amazing, really, the things you see, burnt out cars, all the usual sights. And so I thought, well, I would know, that's for wealthy people, that's for really important people. I would never struggle with pride. But when I became a barrister, I was really blessed. I managed to get into an amazing set of chambers. And even there, I didn't think I'd have a problem with pride because I could tell the people I worked with were prouder than I was. And so I was quite proud that I was more humble than they were. And so I didn't actually think I'd have a problem, although I might have been, but my environment started to shape me. We worked in this enormous Georgian building in central London. I had this incredible office, the best office I've ever had before or since, which looked out onto a beautiful private garden. We had a butler. I mean, who has a butler? It's like, you know, it's after the year 2000. Why would you have a butler? But we had a butler. And everything just subtly told you, you're important. You couldn't do this on your own. And you might have felt that occasionally over the last few terms, the last few years, when people tell you again and again how amazing it is that you're here, when you walk around and you feel what a great place it is. And for me, it was even worse than that, because you'd go to parties and people would treat you differently when they found out you're a barrister. You know, you kind of sense their admiration and respect. They'd be fascinated by what you did for a job. And it was even better if they knew my chambers, because then they'd be really impressed and they'd look at me and they'd say, wow, you work with them. They're brilliant. You must be brilliant. And I'd say, no, 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 no. But inside I was thinking, yes. Yes. And without even realizing it, I started to rely on my achievements and my status, and I started to use that to make myself feel as though I had hit the mark, to meet the standard. And what happened was my heart became hard, I became proud, and I didn't even realize it was happening. And in this story Jesus tells, he says there are two people who go up to the temple to pray, and the first is a Pharisee. And Pharisees, they were well-trained, they were well-educated, they were well-respected, they had lots of status in society. They were viewed as morally having it all together. They were people you would admire. And the Pharisee stands by himself in the temple. And it seems that the reason he stands by himself is because he thinks he's superior to everyone else. And he says this, God, I thank you that I'm not like other people. Robbers and evildoers, even this tax collector. I fast 2 times a week and I give a tenth of all I get. It's really interesting. He stands on his own. He feels superior. And then look at what he says. He says, God, thank you. And when you say thank you to someone, what normally follows from that? You normally say thank you to them and you say something like, thank you for something they've done. Thank you for some aspect of their character. Imagine if I went up to George later on tonight and I said, George, thank you. But I didn't thank him for his beautiful poem. I said, George, thank you that I've been such a great guy to hang around with this week. I've just been great company. My banter's been on point. We've had a great time. I've been really stimulating in our conversation. Thank you, George. I mean, how would he feel? And this Pharisee, the Pharisee says, thank you. And then all he does is he talks about what he has done and who he is. You know, he'd probably be speaking this out loud in the temple. It's almost like he's announcing to everyone else, I'm great. I'm great. Look at me. I'm great. It looks like a prayer, but actually it's a list of reasons why he doesn't need God's help, why he doesn't need a rescuer. And it's partly because of all the good things he says he's done, his moral behavior, but it's also because he can see very clearly in his eyes that there are people who are so much worse than him. Robbers, evildoers, even this tax collector. And one of the ways I have kidded myself is that I'm doing okay on my own, that I don't need God, is I look at others and I convince myself I'm so much better than them. And actually, in a world of billions of people, that's actually quite an easy thing to do. You'll always be able to find someone who you think you are superior to, who you think you're doing better than. It might be someone far away, perhaps someone who holds high political office in another country, a president perhaps, to take a completely random non-contemporary example. Or it might be someone really close to you. It might be someone at your college, even in your friendship group. And you wouldn't say it to them. Actually, one of the reasons you feel better about yourself is because you look at them and you know their faults. And you think, well, I'm doing better than they are. It's obvious to you. But when you see other people's faults clearly, it's almost always a sure sign that you've lost sight of your own, actually. My little brother, Paul, grew up in the same era I did. We grew up in the same house. That's common if you're part of the same family. Not always the case, but it was for us. And we went to the same really rough school, actually. I've said before, it was actually the worst school in Luton. It's not the worst school in Luton anymore, because they knocked it down. But it was at the time. And I actually went from that school in Luton to here. I came here to read law at Oxford. And then I trained as a barrister. And because of my job, I spent quite a lot of time with people who were accused of being criminals. My little brother's always been much more efficient than me. So he went straight from school to spending lots of time with those accused of being criminals. Not in any kind of official capacity. They were his friends. And when I was working as a barrister, I'd sometimes get these phone calls from my brother Paul. You know, kind of, and one time in particular, I remember he phoned me at like 8 o'clock in the morning. It was unusual to get a phone call from Paul at 8 o'clock in the morning. Actually, any time before midday. And he said, Steve, great news, I'm so excited. And I was thinking, wow, what is this, you know? Has he finally got a lawful job? You know, has he met someone? You know, what's the exciting news? And he said, it's great news, Steve. I was arrested last night. They interviewed me all night, but they've just released me and they're not going to charge me. I mean, what do you say? I'm so happy for you. Do you try and encourage him? I'm so glad you've been working hard on your interview technique. I'm glad it's paying dividends. I mean, what do you say? And it was very easy for me to kind of look at my little brother Paul and to say, I'm fine because I'm not like him. Because on some kind of gauge, I'm doing better than him. And it's a very dangerous road to go down to. The great tragedy of this story is that the Pharisee comes to this place to pray. He's so close in one sense. He's so close. But the very things he relies on to give him a sense of his own justification, a sense that he's met that standard, are the very things that prevent him from receiving what he most desperately needs. He thinks he's owed God's good opinion. He thinks he's owed God's love because of all the things he's done, because he thinks he's so much better than the other people. But he leaves unjustified, without being made right with God. I just want to be really frank with you tonight. I hope you don't mind if I am, because I don't know you. I don't know your background. I don't know how tough your life has been. I don't know the battles you've had to fight. I don't know the struggles you've had to face. I don't know what's going on in your life now. But I want to be really frank with you. Some of you actually deep down think you just don't need God, that you can make it on your own, that you can make the grade. And I have been in exactly that place, if that's where you are tonight. And I tried to convince myself of that. I tried to do it on my own. I kidded myself that I could make that grade. And I didn't need a rescuer. And what happened was slowly, over time, my heart became hard. And I'm so thankful that just in time, I realized and I responded to him. And maybe you're in that place tonight and you haven't even realized it's happening until this very moment, and you suddenly realize now that your heart has started to become hard. You need to know, you need to hear tonight, you need a rescuer. Don't miss out. This is too important. You know, I might never see any of you again. That might be a great comfort to some of you. I hope I will. But please hear me when I say this. Don't miss out. You know, if you think on the final day that, like the Pharisee, it's going to work to say to God, look at how great I am. Look at all the great things I've done. That's not going to work. And there's an opportunity to respond tonight. Please take it and don't miss out. So that's the Pharisee. But the Pharisee is not the only man in this story, not the only guy that Jesus talks about. There's also a tax collector. And the tax collector, as I've said before, the tax collectors were despised by everyone. They were looked down on by everyone. They were seen as collaborators with the Roman Empire. They were seen as dodgy. No one thought they were great. And it's fascinating. He's the exact guy that the Pharisee looks down on. He's the very person the Pharisee is happy he's not like. And the tax collector can't even come close. He can't even come to the front of the temple. He stands at a distance. He watches as all this takes place. He would not even look up to heaven, but he beats his chest and just says this, an amazing prayer. It's only seven words in the English, but it's one of the most powerful, one of the most significant prayers you could ever pray in your whole life. God, have mercy on me, a sinner. You know, true humility is not saying you're rubbish at things you're great at. That's false humility. True humility is seeing with 20/20 vision how you stand before God, being in no doubt about how you stand, that without God you're lost, that without God you don't have a hope. And that's what he sees, that he needs God. And you might be here tonight and you might feel so far off. You might have done some things you deeply regret. You might have done some things you're ashamed of. I just sense some of you might be here tonight, and even coming into this room tonight was difficult for you because you had this sense, I'm not sure if I belong here. What if they knew what I'd done? Can I be here? Maybe you hung back because of that. You felt that sense of inadequacy. You were reminded of how you failed in the past. And I've known exactly that feeling. I will never forget as well, one of my colleagues once, we were having a drink after work, and he was saying, Steve, I went to church this Sunday. And this was extraordinary for me, because this guy never went to church. I was just so surprised. And I was like, where did you go? What happened? And he said, well, I just decided to turn up. I said, how was it? And he said, well, in one sense, it was great, but it was really hard. And I said, what do you mean? He said, well, I just sat there the whole time, and I wanted to leave because I just felt that if they knew some of the things that I'd done, they wouldn't want to know me. They'd want to kick me out, and they'd never have me back again. The second he walked in, he was so aware of the things he'd done wrong. And if you feel even a hint of that tonight, you might feel like you're far off. You might be sitting far off. But let me tell you, you are probably much closer than you think, because you actually realize that there's something separating you from God, maybe from other people. You realize there's something there. You know deep down you need a rescuer. And what this guy does is he beats his chest. He beats his breast. He's actually pounding his heart. Such is his desperation. He knows he needs forgiveness. And he says, Lord, have mercy on me. And it's fascinating because the word for mercy he uses is not the usual word for mercy. It means something quite specific. It's helastoimoi. May there be a propitiation for me. May there be a sacrifice for me. It has a particular meaning. And what's happening in the temple at that time is that you would go into prayer together with all the people, and that there would be a sacrifice of atonement, a sacrifice of a lamb, an innocent lamb, to enable people to enter God's presence for people's forgiveness. And he's looking at this. And then he's praying, may that sacrifice be for me. I need it to be for me. And he beats his chest. May that sacrifice be for me. May that price paid be for me. It's not a general prayer for mercy. It's a specific, desperate plea for forgiveness. You know, we need forgiveness. Sometimes we talk about forgiveness as though it's the easiest thing in the world. But there is a real cost to it. We need to be made right with God, and we can't do that on our own. And what was going on, what he was seeing in the temple was just a foreshadowing of what Jesus has done for us, that he was the lamb who was slain, that he came and died on the cross, that God himself has given himself for you. You know, we can't cure the problem on our own. We can't meet the standard on our own. We need someone righteous to do it for us. And in 1 Peter it says, Christ suffered for sin, the righteous for the unrighteous. Why? To bring you to God. Because of Jesus, you don't have to stand far off. You can come close. You can be confident, not in your own righteousness, but in his righteousness. The one who lived the perfect life and died on the cross for you, taking the penalty we deserve to restore our relationship with God. And when you trust that, when you say, may that sacrifice be for me, something remarkable happens. God takes your hard heart. It says in Scripture, God takes your heart of stone and gives you a heart of flesh. God takes your hard heart and he gives you a soft heart. Because Jesus, I mean, when you trust that, it changes everything. Because Jesus met that standard on my behalf, satisfied God on my behalf, he gives me his righteousness. You know, I can know the standard is met. It frees you from having to spend your life trying to prove yourself. It frees you from always having to defend and protect and build up your ego because you're so insecure, because your future is secure, the verdict is assured, and it means you're free actually to make a true impact, a real impact, live a life of real significance where your emphasis, your aim, your goal is not on yourself, but it's on God. So how do we respond to that? Well, you might be here tonight and you might think, well, I'm glad we're done now. The bridge is opening soon. You know, I'm just not interested. Well, thank you for coming. Thank you for listening. If you've been lured here under false pretenses on your way to the bridge, I'm really sorry about that. And actually, where's George? Is he here? George, why don't you come out a second? This is George. George is actually responsible with a few other people for organizing much of this week. And if you feel shortchanged for having to spend your time being here, George would love to compensate you. He doesn't have any money, but it's a little known secret about George that actually he is quite a remarkable, actually an astounding breakdancer. And he looks clean cut, but the guy can move, he can shift. And he'd be happy to give you a display to make it up for you. If you're here tomorrow night at the Cayley, and I would come tomorrow night, if nothing else than to see George breakdance, he'd be happy to just demonstrate some of his skills. He's so humble. He's just, you know, he's humble about his breakdancing skill, but I just think credit where credit's due. But even if you do feel that way, can I just encourage you? We have this amazing thing called The Search, which is on Monday nights in Starbucks upstairs, and there's free drinks and cake, and it's the perfect place to bring your doubts, bring your things you don't agree with, bring your questions and explore some of the big questions in a really relaxed setting where people want to know what you think and you can discuss them. But you might be here tonight, you might be interested, you might have lots of questions, and what you actually need is to chat to someone. So I can just encourage you, we've got coffee at the back, go and grab a coffee, chat to the person who brought you, chat to one of the team, and just tell them what you think. They are desperate to know what you think. Your friend who brought you is desperate to know what you think. They're desperate to know what your questions are. They will be fascinated by them. But you might also be here tonight, and I think there might be two groups of people here tonight. And the first group, you know, actually, right now, that you've been trusting in yourself. And maybe you've been doing lots of things to try and meet the standard, to try and prove yourself to try and make yourself feel as though you're righteous. And there's an opportunity tonight to say, I don't want to trust in myself, but I want to trust in you, Jesus. And can I just say to you, please don't harden your heart. I've made that mistake in the past. There's an opportunity tonight. Take the opportunity to respond. There's no better place to be than in that place where you have complete confidence in Jesus, trusting in him, knowing that actually you need a rescuer. But you might be also here tonight, and actually you just know. You know, you knew the second you walked in, you knew long before the end of this talk that there's stuff in your life at the moment, maybe that's happened in the last month, the last term, the last 2 terms, and it's separating you from God. And you can't quite believe that it would be that simple. It sounds too good to be true. It all seems too easy, too simple, that it could go like that. That when you place your trust in Jesus, the slate would be wiped clean, and you would be in a right relationship with God. Your relationship with others would over time be repaired. It might seem too easy or too simple, but let me tell you, it wasn't easy and it wasn't simple. It cost more than we can ever understand or comprehend. But let me tell you tonight, it is true. And that's what's available for you. So I just invite you just to take a moment, and maybe you just close your eyes, because it's a private moment for those who would want to respond. And we're just going to wait for a moment. I also had a sense, just while everyone's got their eyes closed, that this might be helpful for a few people tonight. Those who try to save their lives, to keep their lives, lose them. But those who lose their lives for my sake will find them. I had a sense that some of you will look back on this night, actually, as it sounds strange to say it, we're in Oxford Town Hall, but that you'd look back on this night as actually, in the years to come, as one of the most significant evenings in your life. Actually, there's lots of possibilities that are going to open up tonight when you respond. Lots of things are going to happen, but the first step is a very simple one. So can I just invite you, if you're in either of those two groups, you know right now you've been trusting in yourself and you know you need to trust in Jesus, or if you know there's stuff separating you from God and you just want to know tonight that freedom of placing your trust in him and knowing that there would be nothing separating you from God, and I just invite you to pray this prayer in the quietness of your heart. It's very simple. It's going to be sorry, thank you, please. So, Lord, I'm sorry for the things I've done wrong. I'm sorry that I've gone on my own way, that I've fallen short. Maybe if there's things that come to mind, you just want to say sorry about those specific things. Thank you, Lord, for Jesus. Thank you that he died for me to win my forgiveness. Thank you that he gives me his righteousness so that I can stand before you as a much loved daughter, a much loved son of yours. And please would you come into my life tonight. Would you lead me on from this place? Would you guide me by your Spirit and by your word? In Jesus' name, amen. So maybe we just keep our eyes closed. And If you just prayed that prayer for the first time or in a way that's significant for you, you know it's significant for you tonight. It might be that in a couple of days you're in a coffee shop somewhere and you think, it's like your mind plays tricks on you. You think, well, I think I prayed it, but did I actually pray it? I'm not sure, I can't remember. There was a lot going on, I was a bit distracted. Someone was coughing near me. I would love you if you prayed that prayer, just to put your hand up. And it's like a way of underlining it. And no one will see but me, but it's a way of saying, I prayed that prayer, and I know I prayed that prayer. And it's a way of you underlining it now. So if you just prayed that prayer for the first time in a way that's significant for you, could you just raise your hand now so I can see it? Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you. From the balcony, can you raise it a bit higher? I can't quite see, sorry. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Anyone else? Thank you. Anyone else? Just sense there might be a couple more. Thank you. I don't want anyone to miss out on this opportunity, so thank you. Anyone else? It's not an auction, but anyone else? It's an opportunity to respond, and I just sense it might be significant, so I just want to give an extra moment. Thank you. Thank you. Lord, we thank you, and Lord, I just pray for every person who prayed that prayer and every person that put their hand up, that you would help them now to work out the next steps to take, who to tell, how to go on from this place. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you so much for listening. Thank you.